introduction to talk. Edward Lawrence was a weather modeler who serendipitously noticed that when he ran a second weather simulation with truncated values from a certain point in his first simulation, as a time-saving measure, that the outcomes of the two simulations, which should have been exactly the same, diverged greatly. His later understanding of this discovery was dubbed the butterfly effect. This discovery would have serious implications with respect to the abilities of modelers to accurately predict chaotic natural phenomena, like weather patterns. In other words, science is unable to create an infallible crystal ball for seemingly deterministic systems. We will analyze other philosophical questions in this same vein with this talk. Main talk. As I sat back watching my cigarette burn, I found myself pondering the possibility of modeling the smoke patterns, the predictability of such a model, and the information needed to model this seemingly simple mixing phenomenon. Assuming a pressure-controlled test area, it occurred to me that I would need a simulation for the convective currents created by the burning cinder, coupled to an appropriate equation of state to relate the density of smoke and air to temperature and pressure. The size, shape, position, and temperature of the cinder would need to be continuously resolved. In addition, I would need algorithms to describe the different flow regimes throughout the smoke column, the laminar turbulent transition, and the smoke's diffusion into the surrounding air. But even if I had high temporal resolution for these data and the computing resources, my prediction would break down without continually correcting for the error between the predicted and the observed. In other words, to create this model would be both computationally expensive and highly dependent upon direct observations. Without adjusting for error, the model would very quickly deviate from reality, but might appear rather convincing. Considered to be one of the last unsolved problems existing in the field of classical physics is the ability to calculate and understand turbulent fluid flow, which is characterized by erratic and irregular flow patterns with rapid changes in pressure and velocity. The Navier-Stokes equations are a set of coupled non-linear partial differential equations that can theoretically describe any given flow problem. However, it has not been proved whether knowing the initial conditions for a flow problem with sufficient certainty will always yield a continuous solution or if singularities exist resulting in undefined points. Therefore, this problem appears to mask a fundamental question about the universe, as well as turbulence. There are really two possible explanations for this result. Turbulent flow is either chaotic or it is purely random, or stochastic. Chaos is the result of deterministic processes whose outcomes are highly sensitive to initial conditions. Despite their deterministic nature, long-term predictability of chaotic systems is impossible. Stochastic processes are non-deterministic, random, and must be analyzed probabilistically. Either way, long-term predictability is impossible and short-term predictability requires a statistical approach that is only as good as the assumptions going into the model. I suspect the reason the turbulence question continues to go unanswered results from the need to go beyond Newtonian physics and incorporate subatomic physics into the computations. Prior to the advent of quantum mechanics, it was thought that Newtonian or classical mechanics would allow the universe to be described at any given time if sufficient knowledge were obtained. In fact, Laplace, a French mathematician and astronomer, was the first to articulate this idea in his work, A Philosophical Essay on Probabilities, published in 1812. There he said, "We may regard the present state of the universe as the effect of its past and the cause of its future. An intellect which at a certain moment would know all forces that set nature in motion, and all positions of all items of which nature is composed, if this intellect were also vast enough to submit these data to analysis, it would embrace in a single formula the movements of the greatest bodies of the universe and those of the tiniest atom. For such an intellect nothing would be uncertain and the future just like the past would be present before its eyes." That statement is now known as Laplace's demon. Perhaps this is the same thinking that led Friedrich Nietzsche, and later Time magazine, to suggest that God is dead. Nietzsche postulated that humans would evolve to become gods themselves with his concept of the Übermensch, which translates to Overman, or Superman. However, scientific advances in quantum mechanics have demonstrated that God can throw dice after all. Notice that Laplace's idea is predicated on the ability to know the position and velocity of all the particles in the universe at one time, an idea that Heisenberg terminated with his uncertainty principle. As I finished the thought, I found myself questioning why, despite these developments and the devastating results that such thinking had in the 28th century, there are those today that wish to play God and impose systems that will allow certain classes of society to attempt to synthesize God's omniscience, omnipresence, and omnipotence. I was also reminded about a talk that I attended where a team of IBM engineers had created a web crawler and data mining program that searched the World Wide Web for certain trends in weather, transportation, trading, policy, and social and political activities in an attempt to forecast energy and commodity prices in speculative markets. This project was also predicated upon the idea that given enough information, it is possible to predict the future concerning complex human systems. This led me to question whether the funding for this project was plowed back from IBM's corporate profits in an attempt to diversify itself, or whether the funding and purpose was more clandestine. For example, InQ Telephone is the non-profit venture capitalist firm, which was launched under Vilma Louie's direction to invest in technologies that are of interest to the larger intelligence community, specifically the Defense Intelligence Agency, the Central Intelligence Agency, and the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency. It is answerable to the CIA and was the original backer of the keyhole software engine known today as Google Earth. Vilma Louie once sat on the board of directors of a national venture capital firm with James Ryder, who was head of Excel when it seeded Facebook with $12.7 million. InQ Telephone is known to invest heavily in data mining. This investment decision may be related to the Office of Information Awareness, which was started by the true inventor of the Internet, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, in 2002 to achieve total information awareness. This was to be accomplished by creating huge government databases and the software to generate complete dossiers on everyone in the United States, through the wireless scouring of every American's personal information, including emails, phone calls, bank accounts, medical records, social networks, travel patterns, credit card purchases, and any other useful record imaginable. The stated goal was to identify suspicious patterns and develop other tracking methodologies for United States citizens. When a reporter, John Markoff, caught wind of this project, he blew the lid off of it and triggered a congressional investigation that ultimately led to the defunding of the project. However, many aspects of this project are alive and well, with funding coming from other black budget programs and perhaps private sources who owe their successes to their seemingly tenuous relationships with the intelligence community. Some of the projects that may or may not continue to exist are human identification at a distance, scalable social network analysis, and futures markets applied to predictions, which is eerily similar to the IBM program discussed previously, and what to be a ghoulish predictive market allowing people to place bets with the federal government on when the next terrorist attack would occur. Futurists are divided about the ability to accurately predict the future. This split depends on their philosophical worldview as either determinists or indeterminists. However, some things are certain. One, complex human behavior is far more difficult than a computational fluid dynamics problem. Two, the interactions occurring in a thinking individual's mind are occurring at the quantum level, which is clearly stochastic in nature and lends itself only to statistical modeling. Three, the systems in which predictability is sought are at the very least chaotic, which does not bode well for long-term predictability, and for these models are computationally expensive as well as observationally intensive. Our society should take a hard look at such model which purport to predict the future. Although much of the economic expense may be hidden by the fact that they are funded with black budgets, the social cost is easy to compute when one looks at the loss of our privacy, the debasement of our culture, and the degradation of our constitutional guarantees. Prior to September 11, 2001, it would have been unthinkable and highly illegal for the intelligence apparatus to have been turned inward on our society in a manner paralleled by the KGB during its reign within the Soviet Union. In evaluating the cost, the benefit should also be explored. Remember, models are only as good as the assumptions that go into building them. It is highly unlikely that this loss of constitutional rights will equate to the ability to accurately predict the next unexpected high-impact social, political, or economic event with enough of a lead time to make a difference, because precursors to and black swan events themselves are outliers that will not be taken into account in any functional short-term predictive model. At best, These instruments will only allow us to look back in hindsight and say that we had all the indicators, which will dupe us into building an even larger and more intrusive mass surveillance network the next time one of these events occurs.